Good morning and welcome to our time of worship as we gather here together on this last Sunday of September, our first of the glorious colors of fall month. I love autumn. I was up north not just this past week and had a chance to drive down some different country lanes and enjoy the vibrant colors that were beginning to express themselves in the beauty of the trees along the road that we were driving. But now we come back in from the outside, or for some of you, maybe you are gathering with me on hopefully a warm Sunday morning on your front porch or your back deck as we gather for this time of worship. We come into this time this morning with praise and with a deep thanksgiving. May our hearts be open. Each of us is part of the whole. We are connected to each other in many ways, and it is through this connection where we together walk the way of peace. Our God entrusts the future to us and calls all of us to be faithful and generous people. So may we hear God's call and accept God's gracious invitation. Let us commit our lives and our hearts to our God of steadfast love, offering all of who we are and all of what we have for God's purpose. And we do that through the many caring ways we express ourselves, as you will see in our newsletter. And so I pass things over to Karen Chandler now to share with you a little bit of what's happening here at Heritage.
Hello and welcome. We have a few announcements and notes for your calendar. World Communion Sunday is coming up on October 4th, and it's a time when Christians around the world break bread together. It's a remembrance of Christ sharing a meal with his disciples and telling them of his time to come. The following week on October 11th is Thanksgiving, and even in this pandemic time, God is good, and we have much to be thankful for. Reverend Lori is looking for some videos from us that will be shared, and if you want to participate but are not quite sure of how to video yourself, please let Lori know, and she will set up some time and come video you, physically distanced, of course, maybe in your front yard or from the porch. Zoom coffee has resumed last week. It is on Tuesdays from 11:30 till 12, and also on Sundays from 11 to 11:30. Lori's hosting the Zoom coffee time again. It's a chance to reconnect and just kind of check in with one another. See how everyone's doing, what's new and exciting. And if you need the link or the passwords to log in to attend, it is available. Just please let Lori know. It's also available in our weekly newsletter. We are looking for pictures that can be included in our weekly newsletter. Pictures of you in your mask, fun pictures of you with your family, some group photos, a selfie, or whatever else you'd like to share with us. And if you want to share some family news and what's been going on, please send it off to Reverend Lori. And thank you for your continued support of our upcoming cookbook. Betty is still accepting recipes, so please be sure to send them to her via email. Please note that if you are going to the church for any reason, you're asked to enter through the side door. You must wear a mask and sign in and out via our contact tracing log when you enter. Sunday morning, children's time, Jesus and Me, will be resuming on October 4th. Be sure to check out our YouTube channel for details on that day. And in our Christian liturgical year, we are now right in the middle of season of creation, which allows us time and space to be thankful and praise our Creator for all that we have been given. This week, take a wander and pay attention to the trees and how good they are for the earth. Let us bow our heads as we pray for the trees. God, we thank you for trees, Help us to see them in many ways and love them as part of the wonder of all creation. Amen.
Boys and girls, I hope you've had a good week. We've hit the season of fall. I wonder how many of you live in neighborhoods where the trees are starting to turn all sorts of colors. I think orange, the ones that have orange on them, are one of my favorites, but the red ones are kind of pretty too. Anyway, I hope that you're on to a good start to fall, that whether you're doing your school online or you're going to class, that you're enjoying being around your friends again, and not forgetting to wear your mask if you're going to school, because it's very important that we keep each other safe. Well, I've got all my friends here with me today. We should say hello, shouldn't we? Mrs. Bonnet, I hope you've had a good week. And there's Peepers the Chip. Oh, and Chimp. How is Chimp today? Of course, we've got Summer Bear. Oh, I love Summer Bear's sunglasses. You know, that's something else that's important to wear. It's important to have sunglasses on. We're out in the bright sun. And Taz, I hope you've had a good week. And I mean that you haven't been too crazy up here up front. I notice everybody seems to be in their spot, so that's a good sign. I have got our Angel Bear back here, our guardian angel, the one that sits on my parents' house in the bed that I grew up at. And Moose is standing at the back to keep an eye on everybody. Moose, I hope everybody's been managing this week. We have also got our fire truck. A reminder again, as I always say each week, to all our first responders who are continuing to do their part in helping to keep our city safe. And all the teachers, I was listening to the news this week, and I heard them talking about a lot more being needed to help with online learning. So thank you to all of you who give of your time so that our friends can learn and grow and maybe become a teacher one day just like you. So thank you. I have got Danny and Lily right down here, who are their friends sitting together. I love Lily's hair. Lily has got pink and orange. She's got very colorful hair. It's very pretty. Of course, I've got Suzanne, baby Suzanne, who is so much like a real baby. Sort of feels like it's time for a baptism in here, don't you think? And of course, I have got Jim, our love bear back here with his big heart. A reminder that we've got so much love in this room and love that extends to all of you. And yes, I saved Joe to last. Joe, so tell me, what has been going on? Oh, really? Joe was did some online learning this week. Math. Oh, and were you sharing your answers with your friends? You were. Oh, very good. And when you've been out, have you been remembering to wear your mask? Oh, Joe says he likes his Batman mask the best. Okay. Yeah. I've got something to show you. I brought something that maybe Batman would have liked back in the day, something to light his way. Let me show you, everybody. I brought with me a very funny looking flashlight. I just love this. My dad loaned this to me the other day. I needed something that took batteries, and this is what he came up with. This would be really cool if you were trying to light something under a desk or something and you couldn't get to it very well. And like I said, my light needs a battery to make it work. You know, I don't really know much about batteries. You can learn about that kind of thing when you get into high school. It needs electricity, and the electricity goes to the battery. But anyway, I don't really know what exactly is in a battery, but I know I need it for my flashlight. Well, I've got a few batteries here. I've got one that says, if you can see that, it says me on it. I've got another battery that says you. It might be backwards for you on the screen, but it says you. And my last one says other, which to me would be maybe some neighbors on your street or some friends from school, but a bunch of other people. So I'm going to try to make my flashlight work here. I'm going to put me in there and see what happens. And, put on the top. No, maybe if I go faster. No. You know what? I think I need you too. I'm gonna put you in there as well, okay? Let's just see what happens. All right. I'm gonna put you in there as well. You know what? There's still room in there. There's more space. Maybe we need the others too. Maybe we need our neighbors to help us with this. All right, I'm gonna put the others in there as well. Well, that's better. There's no space left anymore. All right, now let's put the top on and see what happens. It works. You know, I thought I could do it by myself. God gave me all these gifts and talents. But you know what? God gave you talents, and God gave our neighbors talents. And when we put our talents together, our light shines. And actually, it's not our light. This is God's light shining through us. God's light shines through all of us if when we work together. May your light shine this week in all that you do and say. Have a great week.
There are a few ways to give to Heritage United Church. You can mail a check or checks to the church. You can opt to join in the pre-authorized remittance program called PAR. One easy way is to give on our website. You just go to heritageunited.org pharisees.ca/give. You can drop off an offertory envelope to Carol D's house, or you can e-transfer funds to heritageuctreasurer@gmail.com. The word give, in all its forms and connotations, has been used approximately 1,981 times in the Bible. And the vast majority is references really to what God has given to us. Jesus showed us how to give, and he was the model of giving. He gave of himself to the poor, to those who were sick, to those in need, the marginalized, and those who needed social justice. Giving is not a complicated act. Simply allow the Holy Spirit to dwell within you and give from your heart to the work of the church and God's kingdom on earth as we listen to our offertory hymn now.
Treasures. Let us pray over the offering that we have given. Holy God, we humble ourselves as we offer these gifts. How wonderful that we can take part in your work. Bless these gifts that they may bring healing where there is hurt, compassion where there is indifference, and new beginnings where there are dead ends. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hymns chapter 2, verses 1 to 13. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and in purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only at your own interests, but also the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, in being of nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. Being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as the man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even to death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above all names, that in the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to glory of God the Father. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you and will and to act accordingly to his good purpose. Thanks be to God.
Thank you to Beth Crichton, who shared our first reading from scriptures with us this morning. And let us now hear a reading from the Gospel of Matthew. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from men?" They discussed it among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say from men, well, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work today in the vineyard.' 'I will not,' he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, 'I will, sir.' But he did not go. Which of these two did what his father wanted?" "The first," they answered. Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth. The tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him." God bless these readings from our scriptures this morning. Amen. During some of my time off this summer in August, as I mentioned previously, I watched a variety of movies and documentaries that had some great lessons in them. Two of them were about mountain climbing. Now, I have no interest in actually climbing a mountain, but I've always loved them. There is just something so majestic and mysterious about them. You know, there is a lot that can be learned by studying the mountains mentioned in the Bible. The first thing that we need to understand is that mountains have a lot of spiritual significance. It was on a mountain that Moses had an encounter with God and received the Ten Commandments. It was on a mountain where Abraham was going to sacrifice his son, and God provided a ram in a bush as a substitute. And it was on a mountain that Jesus was transfigured. So, as you can see, mountains have quite a spiritual significance in the Bible. The Bible also speaks of a life as a journey, as a trek. And as we go down life's journey, the path sometimes seems uphill, and at times, a mountain is our path. You may be hearing this today and feel like you are climbing a mountain now. It's not a physical mountain, of course, but you are facing some major obstacles in your life. They may be financial. They might be health-related. They may be relational. A verse from the Bible that comes just before the ones we heard today says, "So Jesus answered and said to them, 'Assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what it was done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, "Be removed and cast into the sea," it will be done." I love this verse because it tells us that if we have faith and do not doubt, we can do incredible things. Things far beyond what we could ever have imagined. And I want you to understand, it takes faith to live your life. It takes faith to overcome its obstacles. I believe that. There are mountains that you will not only have to pray about, but you will have to overcome them one painstaking step at a time. And this brings me to one of the documentaries that I watched this summer called The Dawn Wall. It takes place in January 2015 when American rock climbers Tommy Caldwell and Kevin Jurgensen captivated the world with their efforts to climb the Dawn Wall, a seemingly impossible 3,000-foot rock face in Yosemite National Park in California. The pair, they lived on the sheer vertical cliff for weeks, igniting a frenzy of global media attention. But for Tommy Caldwell, the Dawn Wall was much more than just another climb. It was the culmination of a lifetime defined by overcoming obstacles. At the age of 22, this climbing prodigy was taken hostage by rebels in Khorasan while climbing what was known there as the Yellow Wall. He and his team members escaped in the most life-changing of ways. Shortly after, he lost his index finger in an accident, and he was told he would never climb again, but resolved to come back even stronger. When his marriage fell apart, he accepted the pain of fixating on this extraordinary goal of free climbing the Dawn Wall, blurring the line between dedication and an obsession. Caldwell and his partner Kevin spent 6 years meticulously planning and practicing their route. Tommy felt an urge that could only be described as a calling. A calling to climb that seemingly impossible sheer rock face. Some have called Tommy Caldwell a hero because he had a vision to do something no one else had ever done. And aren't all adventure movies or good stories about people who have felt called to do something that has never been done? Now, very few of us are ever going to do anything like what these guys did. But all of us, you and me, are attempting our own journey, our own climb. The truth is that God sees what each of us is going through and is with us as we attempt to accomplish what we aren't supposed to, or even sure we can. In today's scripture readings, we are also presented with choices of how we'll carry out our difficult journey and who will follow in the process. You know, Jesus knew how to make a first impression. It all started with him riding in on a donkey to the cheers and praises of the people. And then he wreaks havoc on the temple. The tables are overturned and the merchants driven out. In the short time since his entrance to the city gates, Jesus, like a whirling dervish, has made quite an impression on the holy city. You know, I'd be willing to bet that if he was doing this in our city, messing up our church, well, we'd have something to say about it. This time, though, the responsibility fell on the chief priests and the elders of the temple as they gazed around in astonishment at the rubble. What would you have said? Just who do you think you are? Who gave you the right to come here and disrupt things? Who said it was okay to turn everything upside down? By whose authority do you do these things? The question is clearly a trap. If Jesus answers, "God made me do it," which he surely will, they can throw him in jail for blasphemy. And that's the end of their inconvenient tourist. But Jesus is not easily outsmarted. He answers their trick question with a riddle of his own about John the Baptist. Did his baptism come from heaven or from human hands? And now it is the temple elders who are trapped. To say from heaven means believing in John and in Jesus. To say by human hands is a death sentence, because the fear of the crowd outdoors, the mob frantically chanting Jesus' name like a pop star, willing to maul anyone who dares speak a word against him. There is nothing to do but not to give an answer. They simply offer, "We don't know." So Jesus says, "Well, if you won't answer my question, I'm not going to answer yours." I love that. He then challenges them with a riddle, this time in the form of a parable. The gospel reading contains a brief, pointed little parable that virtually everyone can relate to at some level. A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, "Son, go out and work in the vineyards today." He answered, "I will not." But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second son and said the same, and that son answered, "I will go, sir." But he did not go. Jesus then asked the question, which of the two sons did the will of his father? This time the chief priests and elders got the answer right. Better to be the one who eventually gets it right than the one with good intentions who does not follow through. It's a great little story. And when you take a step back, it gets even better. There is no mere story in reply to a challenge by those same chief priests and elders. John the Baptist, a wildly popular religious reformer, had just been put to death, and these henchmen want to find out if this shocking death will be enough to make Jesus quit his ministry after all. They thought they had him cornered, but he turns on their backs by asking for their opinions on John the Baptist, a topic they knew they dare not discuss, lest the crowd turn on them. As they stammered their way toward a non-answer, Jesus posed the parable about the two sons, the one who eventually acted and the one who put up a big front but did nothing. Then he puts these fighting words in front of the chief priests and the elders. "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going to get into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. In the words of this parable, Jesus tells his listeners the importance of actions rather than intentions. Or, as I titled my message this morning, to walk the talk. That lesson in itself is worth imitating. But by his actions, standing up to the self-righteous, self-important proclaimed holy men of his day, we see an uncompromising courage that also warrants imitation. Jesus' words were pointed, specific, fearless, because they had to be. He needed everyone within earshot, his supporters and his opponents, to hear that God's intentions, God's demands for change, voiced by Jesus, as they had been by his cousin, John the Baptist, cannot and will not be frightened off. And in our ongoing work to see a world like the one he promised, where the first shall be last and the last shall be first, we do well to continue to emulate the courage and message of Jesus. Things get even fuller and deeper in our reading from the second chapter of Philippians, which we also heard this morning that Beth read. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. It begins and then describes not only what we should imitate about Jesus, but also those unique and glorious things about him that we can only admire. Biblical scholars are nearly unanimous in their opinion that these verses from one of the earliest, perhaps the earliest, hymn about Jesus, which was we know as Fairest Lord Jesus. I'll leave it to the scholars to argue about whether or not it was composed by Paul or incorporated by Paul from early Christian sources, but the basic idea is this. These words have been used by worshipers from the first days of the Christian church to sing praises to Jesus and to express their dedication to follow him. Whether they sung it in the way we sing our hymns or chanted these words have described the basic Christian understanding about Jesus right from day one. Now back to our gospel reading and the question that we have been put to Jesus. And it's not a simple question as Jesus asks. Which is the good son? The obnoxious yet righteous rebel or the lazy goody-two-shoes? This is because there isn't always a clear choice between right and wrong. In his parable, Jesus did not offer the option of a son who both said the right thing and did the right thing, even the good son in argumentative and disagreeable to a fault, probably quite impossible to live with. No, this is not a simple parable that contrasts right and wrong or words and deeds. Rather, this is a story that focuses on the question of what is right and what is safe. It is the argument itself that matters. When Jesus challenges the religious leaders in Jerusalem, he forces them, as he so often does, to consider an option other than the status quo. By forcing them to agree, he was shaking up their complacency, requiring them to give up their comfort and security and admit there could be another way. He forces them to recognize that things aren't good enough the way they are. Look around you, he said. Your holy city is a mess. Look at the overturned tables and the crowds outside and recognize that things have to change. And you could start by looking more closely at me. Jesus, through his acts of protest, forced a conversation. In doing so, he also forces us to question our reality, forces us to face the essential truth that we could do better. Now, thinking back to the movie The Dawn Wall, Tommy Caldwell had a slow start in life. He didn't even crawl until he was 2 years old. He was not a strong physical child, and he was thought to be mentally challenged by his teachers. But his dad mentored him and challenged him, perhaps too strongly at times, to improve his physical and mental capabilities. After many years of dedication and training, Tommy laid the foundation that would make him one of the world's most elite mountain climbers. Ironically, when one of his colleagues was asked what makes him such a great climber, he said, "He's a machine physically. He never seems to get tired, and he's really smart." Now, you may think, "But I don't really have what it takes to do things like that. I can't even climb the challenge of my life." Here's the thing. The way you start doesn't have to be the way you end up. God doesn't put such limitations on people. In fact, God works with you to overcome the ones you have. I think God actually enjoys taking people with slow starts or those who are disadvantaged in some way and helping them to overcome. This is such a God story because people can be raised up in spite of their weakness, disadvantage, and brokenness. And actually, this documentary about Tommy goes about as deep as you can go. It brings up the fundamental human need every person has to justify themselves. I mean, why do we compare ourselves to other people? Why do we always try to impress each other? Why do we always try to improve ourselves? The irony is that the mountain we see in the Bible that we have to conquer often requires that we work together. We need each other, and we need to look carefully that no one would fall short of the grace of God. It is critical that we decide we are going to finish strong together. And that is exactly what Tommy Caldwell did. He could have climbed the mountain himself, the mountain he'd spent years trying to conquer, but he made a decision that he would fully support his climbing partner who was struggling to make it to the top. Tommy patiently coached and encouraged his friend to keep going even when it seemed impossible. Finally, after several grueling days, they reached the summit together. There are times in life when your calling is going to be that you go into full-on support mode so that your partner can make it up that impossible mountain, so that somebody else can have the victory. And maybe you won't even get recognized by others for the role in the accomplishment. But I can assure you that God sees and is pleased. And on that day, God will say, "Do you see the victory your friend got? That was because of you. That is your victory too. Well done, good and faithful servant." It is not always about us being the winners, standing on that podium. In fact, to God, it's about being a great support to those who do. In the end, both sons in the parable have a decision to make. The kingdom needs both the challenger and the challenged, the protesters and the defenders, the ones who speak up and the ones who listen up. Sometimes our role is to yell loudly for justice. And sometimes it is to speak softly with compassion. And sometimes it's simply to listen, to consider, and to try to answer questions that have no easy answers. And in all we do, we must confront the truth and act justly. Things are rarely good enough the way they are. We can do better. We must do better. And we answer the first son. Let us pray. Gracious and most loving God, we know you're rather busy these days. But we want you to know how thankful we are. You have given us a beautiful world to live in. The sun warms our hearts despite the cooler weather that seems to come too soon. Help us to remember that throughout the changing seasons of life, you are with us. In the midst of our gratitude, we are also mindful of all those who throughout the world struggle this day. A struggle to make ends meet. A struggle because of natural disasters. A struggle because of political unrest. And so we pray for the people and leaders of nations divided, where difference is used as an excuse for violence. Wherever opinions become polarized, when we cease to listen to one another, be a source of calm and reason in the midst of much fear and anger. We give thanks that there are many people who answer your call and labor on your behalf. Open our eyes to the people and situations near at hand where we can help to make a difference. Loving God, we pray for all those dealing with physical, emotional, psychological or spiritual difficulties, their care providers, those at home, in nursing homes, and in hospital who are facing illness, those who are bereaved and are facing other life challenges. We lift these cares and concerns to you now as we take a moment of silence to name those who are weighing heaviest on our hearts this day. We pray, gathering our hearts and voices together now in the words Jesus taught his friends. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please join me now as we share together in our closing hymn this morning, Guide Me, O Thy Great Jehovah. Let us sing.
Thank you.
We go from here renewed and refreshed, eager to be God's presence in the world now and always. Go with God, go with blessings, go with love, and go with an attitude of gratitude. Amen and amen.